Welcome to the SWM podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. I've just about got some sleep. I am joined for the first time on this podcast. Nice to have a first time guest on this season because I've had some past guests before. It's someone who I've only really discovered this year during my hiatus by watching some Target Wrestling, which we'll get into. It's Fulton King. Welcome to the show.
Hello, hello. Thank you so much for having me.
I'm looking forward to this. Like I say, I discovered you, but I first saw you when I was doing all the Target Wrestling just rewatches, because I was up at like 5 o'clock in the morning and I have very little to do. So, you know, YouTube, that'll do.
Yeah, I've been there before.
Oh, it's an adventure. It's very much an adventure of in like trying to time things. It's just a nightmare. But you know, it's fine. It's not like I get paid to do this, so it's not like I'm losing anything. I'm just trying to. I was going to say spread a little joy. It's not that deep.
You're doing it out of the good of your heart, mate. That's
exactly.
It.
Love to hear That's it for everyone listening. I'm doing this out of the good of my heart. So, you know. welcome to the show. It's the first time that I've really spoken to you like in this form, because we're mm-hmm. a little bit of Twitter DMs, because I've been praising you to the high heavens, because I've enjoyed watching Fulton King through Target. So that's a nice pleasantries out of the way. Let's just get into the questions. So first question's always the same, and I listened to Tommy Dreamer's podcast today with Joe Hendry, and I realized his first question is exactly the same. So if it's good enough for Tommy Dreamer, it's good enough for me.
Absolutely, yeah.
How did you get into pro wrestling? What got you hooked?
Honestly, man, I think it was the same as most people who probably enjoyed it, watching wrestling when I was a wee guy. Absolutely loved it. It was when it was on Channel 4 and Channel 5 back in the day. I never had Sky, so I fell out of it eventually, but it was seeing Mankind go through that Hell in the Cell, The Rock absolutely just doing the coolest stuff on the planet, and Steve Austin just being the biggest badass known to man. That was it. I was hooked. I was this wee guy who just couldn't get enough of it. Had no idea when it was on telly, had no idea how I could watch it, but when it was on, I was like, oh, this is amazing. And then everything moved to Sky, and I sort of fell out of it a little bit until I was probably about 16, 17. And then Challenge TV came with TNA. And I remember the first thing I watched, I think it was Generation Me, so the Young Bucks. I think it was them versus like the Motor City Machine Guns or something.
Right, okay.
And that was it weekly from then on. I was like, I'm a TNA guy through and through. AJ Styles is my number one. Samoa Joe is God. So yeah, that's what got me back into wrestling. And then the network came about, which just made everything so much easier. And I tried it when I was 18. I started training. Only went like four times or something like that up at the Source Academy in Glasgow. But I was skint, I couldn't afford it anymore.
Right.
So that's when I was an avid fan, claimed I could do it. I was talking out my ass so much. And then I moved to Carlisle a few years ago, and my ex knew John Natras, who runs Target. And she was, oh, you love wrestling. Why don't you go down and see it? And I was like a big fat mess at the time. And I was like, oh, I don't know if I could do that. But I went down, sat in for one of the training sessions, and I was like got the itch. Do you know what I mean? I was like, mm-hmm. I remember taking bumps 10 years ago. I can absolutely go for this again. Joined in the next week. And then John seemed to like me. I was a bigger guy and I knew sort of what I was talking about. I wasn't really afraid of bumps and rolls and stuff like that. So he was like, yeah, let's do it. Let's get you going. And then COVID hit. So the training was very broken up effectively. So like I trained for a few months and then I had to have like 6 months off because of COVID. And then I trained for a couple more months. And then I was lucky enough to get put on shows then at Target Wrestling.
So we're going to go right back to the start of that, because it sounds like that we're either very similar aged, or we started at the same time anyway, watching the wrestling. Because I was the same. The only reason, it was my friend had the videos, he had the VHSs at $18.99 a pop, you know, he had a bit of money. So I was watching like Royal Rumble 98 and all that kind of thing. And I used to see it on Sky Sports at his granny's house. But I was the same. It was just kind of just luck that you'd find it on the TV, because I was just upstairs probably playing Warzone or something. Obviously WWF Warzone, not the Call of Duty stuff now. Nah, every time I see an ad for it, I'm like, nah, it's WWF Warzone. That's the way it has to be. Or Attitude, which is the exact same, but somehow apparently it was worse. I don't know how, but I enjoyed it anyway. Yeah, and it was just by chance. My mum would try out and just go, oh, some of that wrestling on Channel 4. I was like, clicking the buttons. We didn't have a remote control yet.
Buttons,
I had to go down the way to get to 4. And there it was, Heat. And it was the best thing ever.
I loved every bit of it. I remember when it moved to Sky, mom and dad's friends, they had Sky. So every now and then, if there was like a free event on, the one I always remember is Bad Blood. And it's the one where Triple H and Shawn Michaels in the Hell in a Cell just destroying each other. So he recorded it for me. He videotaped it. For those young ones, you put a video in a cassette and hit record. Halfway through, it just switched to Babe Station, and I was absolutely raging. I was like, "Mate, what are you doing?"
That is incredible. Because I mean, it was one of the during Invasion pay per views. It was it was Raven versus Perry Saturn, a match I'd only ever seen very recently, because my friends. Friends the same. He was a fan as well, so he would get his dad to stay up and record it. And then just before Perry Saturn appeared, Moppy came on the screen, and then suddenly Sky Sports came on, Sky Sports News. I was like, what?
Yeah.
Then came back on, that match was gone. And I've only ever saw it very recently, because I was watching back through old pay-per-views through the network. I was like, I don't remember ever seeing this. That's why, because I saw Sky Sports. That's when I saw Sky Sports News.
Yeah.
But yeah, we always had. There's always a friend. That's what I find doing all these chats. There's always a friend that had, like, Sky Sports. And I remember on digital or ITV digital. So you might get SmackDown on Sky One. But if you didn't, you got Metal on a Sunday.
I watched a lot of Metal. I know of it. I remember seeing like a clip of AJ Styles or something being on Metal, but I don't ever remember watching Metal.
I just remember it was always Sunday, so I'd have to run home from Sunday school, because that's how young I was at the time. So I'd run home and so I could just catch Metal, and it was just the best thing. And this is obviously a tangent. This is your interview, but I'm just going off on a tangent. I just remember Metal being so cool, because did you remember the Panini sticker albums? And it was WWF Metal was the album, was the sticker album. It was.
I think you just unlocked a memory somewhere in my brain. I think that definitely rings a bell.
Blue. It was blue, and it was my mate had all the cool stickers, and I would try and get some when I could, and it was. I remember getting the shiny rock and all that kind of stuff. It was it was the best time. We had trading cards. You know, I need to get in touch with that friend again just to see if he's got anything in his loft, because he had some
to the collection.
He had some cool shit. It was so cool. And I was just like hoping and praying I would get something. Usually it would just be a wrestling figure or something if I was lucky. I'm really gonna have to do that. Anyway, right, okay. So you mentioned like your classics, your Austin, your Mankind, your Rock. But who are who are your guys, who are your boys that you particularly enjoyed watching?
Hardys growing up. Absolutely love the Hardys. I was so upset when I realized I was never going to be able to do the stuff that they did. And then when I got back into wrestling when I was like 16, 17, it was Samoa Joe the entire way through. Like, I loved him. A bigger guy who could move, and he was just a monster. Oh, I fell in love with Samoa Joe. And then not long after that, or maybe a few years after that, I discovered Kevin Steen. I fell in love with Kevin Steen. As a bigger guy, I've always had this thing for bigger guys. I just think seeing these dudes absolutely demolish people, but then still, it's the charisma, I think. I think it's got to be it. Samoa Joe and Kevin Steen are just oozing with this charisma that just draws me to them. And again, I've got that sort of, they've got a similar body shape to me. That means I can absolutely do this. Those guys absolutely are the my go-tos. And most recently, Balls Mahoney. Like,
right, it's a throwback.
Man, Balls Mahoney... it wasn't until recently when people were like, watch Balls Mahoney matches. And I was like, right, okay. And the stuff he was doing, he wasn't just this hardcore chair swinging freak that everyone, like, that he was known for. He was a collegiate wrestler or a high school wrestler. Unbelievable stuff. If you want to get into some deep ECW, watch Balls Mahoney, RVD, 1999 at Anarchy Rules, man. what a match.
When you're talking about the Hardys, I think this is why we kind of have gone along through the old Twitter DMs and that, because it seems like our stories are very similar, but yes. I just decided not to do the wrestling. I decided to talk about it instead, which, you know, is safer for me. But with the Hardys thing, I was the same. Me and my mate, we did the wrestling at school, of course, because we're idiots. And I was the one who climbed on stuff, so I was Jeff Hardy. I was always Jeff. Yep. But did you find when you say like you saw him, he's like, well, I can't do that. But in that kind of that thing with the Hardys, I remember having a pair of total 90 trainers.
Right.
If you remember the football boots, the total 90s, they had like, yeah, so they're kind of just about similar to Jeff Hardy boots as much as you could. So I'd always wear that. I had them, so I wore them, and I wore combats, but they weren't like.
Like the big, like the big baggy Jenko jeans they used to wear, sort of stuff.
I had a pair of those as well, and they were navy blue, but they had like white stitching around it. So I was like, whoa, this is my Hardy's gear. This is the best thing ever. So if I couldn't be them, I would at least try my best to look like them, which has obviously worked for me here. I don't think I may look like Papa Hardy when he was a bit elder, but it was just one of those things. You watch these guys do all these amazing things, like, well, I can't do it, but I'm going to try and replicate as much as I can of them.
I'm going to try and look like them, and then SmackDown versus Raw, I'm going to make me as one of them.
Or just
Here Comes the Pain, or just SmackDown back in the day.
Oh, I remember, I mind making myself, and I don't know what I was thinking, but I remember I have like flashbacks of one. I had a mohawk, but not like the big up mohawk. I had the hair, and then it just spiked in the middle.
Like the full one.
Yeah, that's the one. And I had a string, like a mesh vest, like Christian would wear. And I'm looking back at it now, going, why did I ever think that was a good look for a created character that was supposed to be me? No, that's not. I can't pull that off. I look like Rabsy Ness, but if I tried that now. So your favorite's TNA. Love TNA. I remember the wrestling channel. That's where my TNA love came from. And you're mentioning Joe. You're mentioning Kevin Steen, of course, Kevin Owens. That seems very, very apt from when I've seen you do some wrestling. That's clearly where you're kind of picking some pieces from for your character. So that initial first training, though, for Source. So you went to Source. How did you find it? How you say you did four and realized that you're skin, so you couldn't do any more. But how was that first taste?
I loved it. Absolutely loved it. So, for a big demo was one of the trainers at the time, and we had to do a deck of cards workout, which I'm sure people have probably spoken about before. Every suit is a different exercise, and you just pull them and go. And I was an absolute tatters. Never really done sports growing up at all. Was never a football fan. I think I dabbled in rugby, but I hit my head and I was like, I'm not doing that anymore. So I decided to go for wrestling.
Makes sense.
Absolutely loved it. Loved bumping. I was god awful at it. Like, I was terrible. I was 18 years old, very overweight, very out of shape. But I think I knew at that point, like, if I could keep doing this, I was going to keep doing it. And it was just the money that unfortunately stopped me. I loved it. The first bump, I still remember how it felt. And I was in absolute bits after it. I was like, oh, what am I doing here? But I wanted to do it immediately again. I just wanted to get as good at it as possible. Loved it.
So I like hearing that from wrestlers, because it seems, because I've never done it, never bumped. I've got in a ring, I've done a few, like I've done some ring announcing and stuff. So very, very limited and low impact stuff. This is past Saturday. I tried to sit myself onto the apron for a photo, and I think I thought I injured my wrist because I was trying to pull my body up. I was like, no, this is a sign that it's definitely not never going to be a thing. But yeah, I always like to think if I do take that first bump, that'll be it. I'll be like, that's fine, I can do that again. But it's just that building the, and I'm 32 now, so it's not. I'm quite happy just to leave it in the past and leave it there. So demo was there. So as far as like British wrestling, Scottish wrestling in general, how was it through Source you found out about it? Was that just or did you find out about Scottish wrestling then you went to Source? How did that kind of connect?
I think I found out about Source and Scottish wrestling at sort of a similar time. I learned about the Source, and then I was like on the website looking through it, and I seen like Joe Coffey and stuff like that back in the day. And he, I think he'd just been easy to one at the time. So I was talking to him about that because he'd show up every now and then. And I was just like, I can't believe that it's like so local, like Glasgow, the south side of Glasgow. I can get there. Like I'm from Silcoach. So the only other, what became a huge deal was Grado. I grew up like 2 minutes away from Grado effectively. So he was like a local legend that everyone knew about, and his ICW, you know, get Grado book stuff absolutely blew me away. So yeah, learn about the source, learned about like the coffees and stuff like that. That's when I met Big Demo and I started looking at his stuff, and then ICW really started to emerge around about a similar time, just a couple of years after. And then I never really went to a lot of shows because I was skint pretty much all the time. I went to a couple in Largs, like Vikingar and Largs. And the only thing I always remember from it, it was Wolfgang and Jack Jester had a match. And I thought it was hilarious at the time. Wolfgang came out with like the end of a clothes, like, you know, a clothes hanger, and just chased Jester around the ring for 3 minutes. And I was like, this is the best thing I've ever seen in my life. Why isn't this on telly? but yeah, man, so Scottish wrestling, never managed to get to a lot of shows, always skint, but whenever I could watch it or whatever, I could go to the little local shows, I was absolutely always there.
So of course you apply your trade primarily kind of on the borders with Target. So you had your break, and then you came back to it. What brought you back? Was there a moment that you were like, you watched something, caught it, and were like, yeah, this is, I'm back in the game?
Like get back into wrestling, it was TNA.
Yeah, TNA. He said challenge. That's fine. So yeah. Okay, cool. That's fine. I'm just trying to formulate it. See, rusty. Still rusty.
Don't you worry about it.
That's fine. But I'm trying to pretend I'm a professional, but I'm still not. so you go back to, so you target John Natras. Here we are. This is where we're up to date from our initial question. So you started at Target, of course. A lot of guys that are wrestling through, like your Shady Natras as well, Medallion and your Ivy Mist. So what was like getting back into it? So was it just like riding a bike? When you hit that first bump again, you were like, oh, I remember this. Or was it, I forgot how painful this was?
No, it was, I remembered exactly how sore it was when I did it. Took the first bump back and I was like, oh, yeah, there it is. And I just kept getting on with it. It was a lot different from the other training I'd been to. Not in like a good or a bad way. I just think the style, the training that they do down at Target suited personally me more because it was more wrestling, like bigger moves. So when I was at Source, it was a lot of, if I remember, like tech stuff as well, like wrist locks, hammer locks and all that. And that's really cool. But when I was 18, I didn't have the attention span for it. Right. I wanted to suplex, powerbomb, all that stuff. And when I went to Target, that's sort of what we did. So I quickly, it was very small sessions because it was just, remember there was like a small break in the pandemic where you could sort of do activities. So there was only like me, John, who was training me, and like one of the other boys there. So I think because of that, I managed to pick things up pretty quickly. I had a lot of time rather than it being for a full group of like 12 or 13 guys there. But yeah, no, it hurt. And my body ached so much after it, like walking like John Wayne, barely being able to move, going into the office the next day of my shoot job, and they were like, "You okay? You've got like a black eye." And I'm like, "Yeah, no, it's fine. Don't worry about it. Let's just keep going."
You should see the other guy.
Yeah.
So yeah, like you're saying, I didn't even think about that until you said, but I know from watching Source and then watching Target, you're right. It's Source is a bit more like more focused on the moves and the flow of the moves and that, and then Target's a bit more like there's an overarching story, but it's a lot more big move and all that kind of stuff. I hadn't even thought about it. And I've seen other places of course it's a podcast, I'm going to mention WrestleZone, but like WrestleZone's a bit more like character based, so the wrestling's almost secondary to it, although the wrestling still has to be good, but it's more as long as you got the character, you can kind of get away with quite a lot there.
Definitely.
So Target, it seemed to fit your kind of mold. And like you say, if you're only having 2-to-1 training sessions, you're more focused on.
Yep.
If you're in a group setting at that point, your mind could have just wandered away and If he's focusing, if John's focusing on two guys in one corner, you'll be in the other corner just going and just leaving that your mind to wander.
I think the thing that got me when I first started going to the bigger sessions when they came back was it would be like, wait, everyone's going to try this move. And I would just be shitting myself the entire time. Like, I'm going to do something wrong here. But when it was really small sessions, it's just like, go do the move. And then you do it. And if you make a mistake, it's like, that's fine, we can fix it, don't worry. And then you eventually get it. That's what really did it for me. As much as you've seen me wrestle and I'm a big loudmouth that doesn't shut up and I'm always there, I'm always still in the same set, the mindset of, how am I even doing this? How am I getting away with this stuff?
So a bit, good bit, again, another common thing of all these wrestlers, it seems to be they're closeted, just riddled with anxiety. And then as soon as the bell rings and they go out to go past the curtain, it's like, you're not even you're Fulton King. That's who you are.
That's exactly it. If ever I'm with new guys on the debut, I say that exact same thing to them. I'm like, just remember, boys, when you make it through that curtain, you're not you anymore. You're your character. Even if you share the same name, you're the character. Mm-hmm. And it works for me. It absolutely works for me. So hopefully it works for them too.
So it means, like you're saying, it was really quick from you. I mean, you had a really like staggered training, and then you're on shows very quickly after the pandemic. Well, ended. Has it ever ended? But when it kind of slowed down and stopped, and we're allowed to do things again. So when you're putting together like your debut, I mean, cage match is quite ropey, but I've got your debut down as about September 2021, ish.
Yes, that was my official match debut. Yeah.
Right. So, okay. So what was your pre-debut then? Was it, were you under a mask? Was it a gala?
No. So the first time Fulton King appeared in a wrestling ring was Target's first show back. They had a weekender, so they did a Saturday and a Sunday show at the Hallmark Hotel. And me and a few boys that became known as the Spawn of Target decided to make our presence known and do a bit of battering. So that's the first time I was in the ring. And then a few months after that, I got to make my actual in-ring debut.
Right, as a wrestler. So we'll go to that bit then, the Weekender. I spoke to Shady about it way back in the archives, because I think I was trying to do like preview shows, and that's kind of just fallen down the wayside because, you know, time. So that first time you went out there, nobody knew who you were then. You were just part of this kind of group, this faction of bathroom folk. How did you find, was that riddled with anxiety? Were you like, oh my God, what if I go out and just nobody cares? So what if I go out and absolutely batter this boy because I'm not ready? So how did you find out it was happening, and then how did you feel about how it went?
So I was told it was me, Chris Kendall, and Owen Michaels. We were the initial three members of the Spawn of Target. And it was actually them that said to me, this is what we're doing. Get in the crowd. So I was in the crowd for most of the first show, and terrifying. I was like, what if I trip up? What if I fall? What if I really genuinely batter someone a bit too much? What's going on here? But then as soon as the cue was go, it all went away. And again, I became Fulton King. And I think it's really bizarre. So I'm reasonably confident when I get on to a stage, for example, because I've spent years in bands and years doing music growing up and stuff like that. And it's always been the same thing. You've got your on stage personality. So it's the build up to things. Like, let me tell you, when I was sitting in that crowd, I said, I could just leave. I could just go. I could leave. And I've had that thought so many times, just out of sheer fear and panic before I'm going to have these matches. But then I know as soon as I hit the curtain, I'm absolutely sound, absolutely grand. But you know, it felt amazing being up there and doing it, and then getting chased out by a bunch of faces.
I just imagine a sliding doors moment where it could have been the case, they'll do the cue and you've just got an empty seat in there, and it never happened. And there was no Fulton King, and there was a very awkward beat down for the Spawn of Target, because they're like, the two of us.
Sorry guys, this isn't as big as we thought it'd be. But no, it was really fun. It was who did we batter? It was me, Owen, and Chris decided to take our frustrations out on Soldato and Sammy Sparks. The irony in that.
They probably deserved it.
They did.
Wearing masks and everything, you know, they've got a nomination, I tried to pick a word I couldn't say. they could be anonymous. There we go. And you're not. Anyway, right. So spawn a target. So that's quite a big thing to start your journey in, because it was a group, a faction that kind of was the focal point of these target shows since the restart. And even now there's still kind of fragments of what's happened going forward. So that's a year of story right there and then of you guys putting medallion through a table. You just battered folk for any reasons. The team itself won titles and all that kind of stuff. So it's quite a big thing to push you into straight away. Did you find, like you said, you mentioned you're quite confident because of working with in bands and that. Do you think that was pretty much that was the reason why you were able to handle that kind of pressure straight away?
I think so, yeah. Like, don't get me wrong, there was definitely some shaky moments, but I think, again, as I was saying, yeah, in bands and stuff, that confidence was there when I hit the stage, and that's what let me flourish. But everything leading up to it, it took so many people to tell me, it's all right, mate, you can do it, you're fine, don't worry about it. Like, so many people had to, like, calm me down before every show. It was ridiculous. But yeah, it was, that getting put into that was like, I was shocked at first because my training, again, it was very fragmented. So overall, I probably had like 4 to 6 months of training before that sort of kicked off. And it was, I guess, it was like a sink or swim sort of situation. And I think luckily I managed to start off floating and eventually got my legs and started swimming at least.
Absolutely. So when I came into this whole Target Wrestling watching, it was the 9th anniversary of the show, was the first one I saw. So that again, that would have been, what was it, April? So about 6 months-ish of the Spawn being a thing at that point. And I think, was it yourself or was it the team itself that were tag team champions at some point during that as well? Was it just like a free bird rule?
We treated it, I claim that I was a former Target Wrestling tag team champion. I never defended the belts once, but I definitely carried them out and stuff like that and had matches and stuff. But so I'm claiming it was a free bird rule, even though it was never specifically said.
So we'll run with that then. So you're less than 6 months and you're a couple months into your time as a wrestler. And you're already a champion, technically, it's on my records as you being a champion, so I'll take it as is. I don't know how much of a belt guy you are, but was when you were able to get a hold of those belts, was that kind of like a, oh my God, I've actually made it kind of thing, or what was that?
It was so surreal. It was so surreal. Because, again, you grew up seeing all these guys, you know, belts are... It's the idea, growing up, it was, oh, those are so cool. But now it's the idea of you've been trusted by this company to, you know, carry the torch a little bit. And it was so surreal. And I was just like, I can't believe I'm part of this. This is truly unbelievable. I am genuinely thankful every day about all the stuff I've managed to do in wrestling in the short time that I've managed to do it. But I was so thankful. I think your message, you know, the owner of Target like a million times saying, thank you so much. And he was just like, shut up, mate. But yeah, so surreal, so just so excited about it. Yeah, I still remember the feeling, like, it was amazing. Truly amazing. I couldn't show it, though. I was a bad guy. I used to drag it across the ground going, oh, I hate myself.
As soon as you get backstage, like, you pick up again, I'm so sorry.
And you polish it off.
Just spit shine it. I'm so sorry what I've done to you. So what did your like friends and family think of this? Were they not surprised that you went for the wrestling, or what was their kind of reaction to it?
I don't think they were, because a lot of them knew that I tried it years ago. And then when I moved to Carlisle, I moved alone. I didn't know anyone here. So there, I was like, it's just, initially it was just going to be for fitness. Like, I just wanted to do something to get into shape. And it just turns out that John thought I did pretty well, and he was like, I'm putting you on shows. I was like, oh God. My mum and dad were not surprised in the slightest. They knew I just get up to some stupid stuff, like bands for years, wrestling back in the day. I think at one point I told them I was going to become an actor. I think at one point I told them I was going to do stand-up comedy. I think the more thing they're surprised about is that it's stuck. to be fair.
Right.
That's it. Yeah. My friends love it. They think it's amazing that I'm a wrestler because a lot of my friends are big wrestling fans as well. And they think it's hilarious. We've got like a bunch of different wrestling chats where I just constantly post things. Like I find some random move and go, what do you boys think of this? Think I could pull this off? And they're like, yes, or do not even dare try that, Fulton. Sorry.
that's quite amazing that all the things that, like, so we've already discussed that before you do any of these things, you're quite anxious, but all the things that you've put forward as what you wanted to do or what you said you wanted to do were all front-facing in front of a crowd. I don't know if it's more of a case of all these things are on a stage so you can just be someone different. I don't know if that's a thing it's there as well. But yeah, it's just curious that all the things that you've picked are all very much on the spotlight is on you.
I think I'm just really not nice to myself with that stuff because I know the build-up absolutely kills me, but then it's when you burst through the curtain or when you get on the stage with an instrument, it's that there's something really cathartic about it. It's that's the release and everything goes out there, and then there's no better feeling than something like that, I don't think.
So going through a little bit your journey then, so the spot on target was the big thing. So that was going through the whole, like I said, over a year of stories through Target, and you'd have tag team matches, you'd have singles matches, and I was always, you mentioned Kevin Steen, and I was very much, that's the kind of like character and style that I saw when I saw you wrestle anyway, like not just because of the body shape and the attire and everything, but it was the, I don't know, Kevin Steen's got this kind of like nonchalant attitude, but he's still really good. He's in control of everything at the same time. So I was seeing like kind of sparks of that at the same time, because that's just, I don't know how, there's an art, also one of my favorite wrestlers, Aspen Faith, and he's got that kind of same vibe where it's like he's so cool, but he's so nonchalantly cool about doing all these cool things. I'm like, oh god, how are you so relaxed doing this? So that's kind of vibe I was getting from watching yourself, because it's like, you just make it look, if you can make it look easy, then it just looks cool at the same time. So I haven't written down matches you've had, but was there any particular matches you're proud of through that Spawn of Target time?
Yeah. So there's a match that I really loved, and I watch it back pretty regularly. It was me and Madman Matthews, who became the fourth member of Spawn, and we were accompanied by Buddy Roller, who became the fifth member of Spawn, versus Soldato and Sammy Sparks for the tag team belts. I absolutely adore that match. One of my favorites. We decided, let's just have an absolute war, and that's what we went for. Other matches was the myself and Owen versus Martin Kirby and Tommy Oliver. At the time, all the matches I'd really had were kind of insular for, you know, Target's guys. And then having that match against Kirby, I was terrified. I was absolutely terrified. You know, it's like, he's like, to me, this giant name in British wrestling. He's everywhere. I really hope I don't stink the place up. But it went really well, and I was super proud of that too. And my first main event, the first ever main event I had, was me versus Sammy Sparks again. Me and him have fought each other back and forth so many times. Me and Sammy Sparks main evented a show in Dumfries. And again, similar to the idea of someone putting the belt on you, when someone's like, you guys are closing out the show as the main event, it was one of those things like, wow, you're really putting a lot of stock into this. This is amazing. And I'm really proud of that match. We tore it down. And it was like, I don't think they'd realized that, because me and Sammy had so many matches together, it built this sort of mini storyline within another storyline. Mm-hmm. So to me, it was like the blow off of that. And I was really excited about it and really happy about it. And again, we just battered lumps out each other like we tended to do.
Well, those were just beforehand, obviously had all the anxiety stuff, but you had the My Way promo going, and you were the one sitting there going, I have to beat you, Sammy.
It needs to happen, Sammy. We've been in war too many times. Yeah, no, 100%. And it was so worth it. And again, it's that, I said it before, when you do stuff on stage, at least I find that all that tension and fear and anxiety builds up and builds up, and then you burst through that curtain, it turns into this cathartic experience that's unmatched, I think.
So when you started, what you mentioned, of course, you mentioned Kevin Owens and Samoa Joe, but was there any guys and Balls and Honey. But is there any guys that when you were proper on shows, not training, but when you started shows, that you were like, right, I need to go and watch, see this guy, I need to maybe pick up something from this guy, or in either in the UK scene or just in general, where were you studying?
Honestly, I try and watch as much wrestling as possible. So whenever I'm on a show, I try and watch every single match I can. I don't think that there's anything, you know, other than actually working a match, there's nothing more beneficial than studying it as much as possible. So Shreddy Brick, another big guy, obviously a different kind of big, he's a big bodybuilder. I used to watch a lot, whenever he was on, I'd watch a lot of his matches just to see how you can have big guy matches, because I was with a lot of smaller guys. So his match with Big Demo, I watched it live and I've watched it back so many other times. DCT, he is just, as a big character guy, and he is a big character guy, I was like, I want to try and watch how he does all this sort of stuff as well. I'm trying to think, who else have we had? We've had so many people. Josh Terry. As much as I can't do half the stuff he can do, watching him wrestle is just truly amazing. And even within the guys from Spawn, like, I attribute how far I've gotten because of that, you know, the first few months with those guys. So Owen Ozzie Michaels, Chris Kendall, Buddy Roller and Madman, like, these guys are fantastic wrestlers, and I got to sort stuff out with them, work with them literally nearly every single day. Like, Owen and Chris and Buddy are unbelievable, and spending that time with them really solidified my base and the stuff that I can do, I think. So them, I'm trying to think about a really good match. Lycos Gym, versus Buddy and Owen was an unbelievable match that I got to sit ringside for it. Like, shouting abuse at Lycos Gym, obviously, but still watching the stuff that they were doing and the intricacies. It was just amazing. I watch every show I'm on, I try and watch every single match on the card and ask as many people as I can about their match and all the stuff they put together. I'm probably one of the most annoying people to be in a show with.
But saying that, though, it's not a bad thing at all to do, because you're learning. But also for, again, an ebb and flow of a show, because there's been shows where I'll watch back on YouTube or what have you, and the two matches in a row will do the exact same thing, and I'm watching it going, there needs to be communication somewhere in this, because I mean, I don't mind, I'm behind the barrier, I'm behind the TV, I'm behind the screen, it's not my opinion that kind of matters a whole awful lot. But if I'm watching the first two matches and they end in a DQ and they do the exact same opening sequence, I'm like, oh no, this is terrible.
Definitely not.
The rest of the match will be fine, but that moment, no, shouldn't have happened. So yeah, if you're watching the shows, you get the kind of rhythm of what a medallion will do, say what a Shaded and Trust would do. You kind of get their intricacies and what they kind of do is their, what's it like in the video games, you'd have their wake up kind of,
their comeback, their wake up,
comeback, kind of stuff. So you learn what that is, so you know, right, we can avoid all that. Shady does this amazing massive drop kick from the top rope at this point in the match. I don't need to do that. That's fine. I can leave that to him. So it's,
thank God. I definitely don't want to be doing a massive drop kick from the top. I need to say as well, Medallion, and I've obviously worked quite a bit with Medallion as well. He's been fantastic in regards to, you know, watching and studying, because he's a bigger guy in stature, not as big as me, but still a bigger guy. And he was actually my first ever singles match. And I was truly terrified for that as well. But he's a very character guy. And although it doesn't seem like it, like, if you watch a Medallion match, he doesn't do all this crazy fancy stuff. He shouts Medallion and has a scrap. And it's amazing. Oh, yeah. And that's the sort of stuff that I've always loved, that sort of stuff. So wrestling Medallion and watching Medallion really helped as well.
So it's anyone reads my reviews, they'll know when I've got a match where it's just a guy who just bars folk, because it'll start with the match started, and then there's like, it feels like a long pause, and going, and this is how it finished, because like because all that's happened is Medallion's come in and smacked someone about for a bit, and the match is finished. I don't know how to I enjoyed it, but I don't know how to actually write it.
Like, you were engaged, you get engaged through the full thing. And that's one of the things that I think he does so well. Like, he can have a match where it is a big brawl or it is a big scrap, and you're so engaged in it. And you're like, wait a minute, what did I just watch? That was amazing. What happened? That's one of the stuff things I love about Damien.
It was like, oh, what moves were done? I don't know. He slapped him in the chest. Kicked him. That was about it, to be honest, but I enjoyed it. Enjoyed being there for it. So obviously years passed, and then the Spawn of Target, they kind of get a losing streak. They start getting silly losses, and then eventually they split. So you get attacked by Buddy Roller and Owen Ozzie Michaels, you and Chris Kendall, who just returned like a month or so beforehand.
Yeah.
And you had this absolutely mental match to kind of draw out or finish off the chapter of the Spawn of Target. Because I remember watching it, and that Chris Kendall dive out of nowhere. I don't know who's in charge of the camera. I'm going to guess it was an accident, but Jesus, it was just out of nowhere. There he was. Was that the kind of thing where you'd had a year of going, right, we've learned, we know what we can do. We're just going to go in and just go absolutely nuts for 20 minutes.
Yeah, that was pretty much the plan. We knew this, once the split happened, we're like, okay, this has been a year in which we have been, again, as you said, sort of the focal point and run through nearly every Target show. We can't just go out and have your classic 15-minute, you know, technical lockup, armbar. That just isn't going to work for us. It didn't work for us as we were Spawn either. We really didn't do that. We had to go out and truly batter the living shit out of each other. And I think we did. That's another match that I'm really proud of, like super proud of that match. From the brawl right at the beginning to taking my first ever pile driver, which I was also scared of, to using Owen to break up a pin that Buddy
I loved that. I loved that. It was just great.
We realized, let's just go out there and absolutely give it everything we've got. We do that every single time, but this one had, to us, it had more stakes. Mm-hmm. It was the first time in a long time Chris had really been shown. It was me sort of, you know, coming out as the good guy, I guess. You know, the Target fans, I was really nervous. I didn't know how the Target fans were going to deal with, you know, me coming out as the good guy. And Owen and Buddy were just as slimy as ever. But we got the win with a big assisted King's Landing, and it was, I loved that match. Absolutely loved it. And I think the crowd did as well, thankfully.
Yeah, I mean, on the YouTube, it's the crowd's kind of been turned down a little bit because they put commentary over the top, so I didn't really get the kind of reaction as much as I possibly would have liked to hear. But the match itself, it seems to happen quite a lot, so it's not something that's like a pet peeve, but when it's a blood feud, when it's a, like this kind of personal feud, I never want to see a lockup to start off with. I want to, you can't have the betrayal, the revenge, and then go right collar and elbow. Let's start this up, and we'll do a drop down, leapfrog. No, you go in, you smack them. That's the start. That's how you go.
We're fighters, you know. Like, I'm 6'3", 4 foot wide, and I'm going to run at you with every single part of my body to get you down. And that's exactly what we did. Owen absolutely launched himself at us over the top rope.
Yeah.
You know, caution went to the wind, and we just wanted to go out there and absolutely put on the best show we possibly could. And I would
definitely recommend that match to anyone who wants to go see it, because it kind of set the tone when Owen did that jump and like just got yous. But because how the camera had it was just like he'd just fallen, but just kind of, it was just, the camera work was, like I say, possibly accidental, but it was incredible at the same time because it just added everything to it and made it as chaotic as the match was. And it was a lot of fun to watch. So it's definitely worth going checking out if anyone's wanting to go check out on the YouTube. So that's it. Your Spawn Target is done. You're the good guy now.
You're
allowed to be cheered for, which is nice.
Very bizarre. Very bizarre.
Which I enjoyed because I'd spent like the last three shows going, I really like this Fulton King guy, but I know that I'm not supposed to like him, but I like him. So come on, ramp it up. And as soon as they attacked you, I was like, yes, I can cheat him. That's fine. So I had that, and then of course you had your breakout match really with Shreddy as well in Annan, I think it was.
Annan, yep.
Yep. So that was your, and our main event, was the main event, did it close the show that night? Or
yeah, yep. Main event for the Target Heavyweight title.
So you started as this big group where you were kind of a tag team guy. You built yourself up, got a couple singles matches here and there, and then now that's went by the wayside and you're in the main event for the title against a guy you'd watched and admired as a big guy wrestler. So, you know, no pressure or anything, but how did you find the match went?
I had a great time. My body didn't. It was so sore. It started off, Shreddy comes out, cuts this promo calling, you know, the people of Anna and everything under the sun. I'm just like, you know what, mate? Let's just have a fight. You'll find this a lot with me. I just like to go out and actually have a fight. So I came out, cut a little one myself, had a fight, stormed the ring. We just went back and forth about, I think we may have accidentally broken a chair, which I don't think the match is up, but we did a lot. We got them onto like the big, you know, the chairs you'll see in like restaurants and hotels, the big thick metal ones with the sat them on one of them and just launched myself for a crossbody. And the leg bent and we went flying. And there was chops left, right, and center. There was punches thrown. I managed to get them over my head for a big fall away, which I was very excited about, but took me out at the end with a big belt shot that left me down there. But honestly, I was terrified again beforehand. Like, I was absolutely terrified. And when I was told it was happening, it was just so nonchalantly. It was, oh, just to let you know, it's you and Shreddy in the main event for the title. And excuse me, are you sure? And then it never gets spoken about until like the day before the show again. And I was like, oh no, I'm so scared. But yeah, I was very happy with that match. Shreddy's a great worker. He goes about everywhere. He's obviously in fantastic shape and he's an imposing figure. But no, we went out there and just slapped the shit out of each other. My chest was feeling it the next day, man. Like, we weren't kind.
Whereas his is like a rock, so I probably didn't feel much.
Yeah, he was probably absolutely fine, but every time he hit me, I was like, oh, come on.
Stop it. Just, I need to breathe at some point.
Stop hitting me.
So from that point onwards, of course, you had your team with Chris Kendall, which is, according to the results I've seen, has turned sour recently. So yeah, that's all the spawn of Target that are against you now.
I don't know what it is, man. Like honestly, everyone in Target just turns on. It's a bit bang out. I think I'm quite a nice guy, to be fair. I feel like you go watch any of the old matches back when it was a tag team one, or even if it was on ringside, I was always checking in on the boys, and they kick me in the balls or just leave me for dead.
I mean, you did mention earlier that you probably do find yourself annoying them more often than not, asking questions, yeah, and that maybe they're just like, nah, we're done. We're done answering questions. That's it. Get out.
Yeah.
So from that there though, like kind of a wee side project on the like side team. Of course, Sammy Sparks as Legends Never Die. You were popping up in was Preston City Wrestling, I think I've got down here. As that team. So how did that come about? Was it just you guys went down and you became a team? How did this bond begin?
So me and Sammy have been in so many matches together, and we ride a lot together, and we just thought, you know what, why not just team up? I'm sick and tired of fighting you, and you're sick and tired of fighting me. Let's see what we can do together. And we actually, it all sort of came about when we went up to the LKS, Luke King Sharp's Dojo of Excellence, and we were working a lot together, sort of just getting shoved together to do a little tag stuff. And someone had said to Luke King, oh, do you put those guys together because they're an actual team or something? And he was like, no. And then we're like, oh, maybe there's something here. Let's kind of run with this. So again, we know each other so well. We see each other pretty much every day and we've battered lumps out of each other countless times. And so we just get to do it to other people now. And I like I think it's a really fun dynamic where you've got, you know, little chaotic Sammy who doesn't stop moving ever. And then obviously Big Fulton King is just ready to pick people up and throw them about. great. It's fun. It's really fun. We went down to PCW to sort of try it out. So we know some of the boys down there. So we went out and we tried it out in front of a live crowd. Worked really well. All right, let's do this again. We managed to get booked a couple more times from it too. Again, we're actually undefeated in PCW. So Death Row, we're coming for those belts at one point. I just thought I'd throw that out there. But yeah, and the guys down there seem to like it. And then we've just decided, you know what? This could work. You know, this team in between me and Sammy, we could do some stuff with it. So we're going to run with it, see how far we get, and hopefully we get pretty far.
So you spoke about LKS Dojo of Excellence, of course. And when I was speaking to Lou for the Dane spot in preview, he mentioned that you and Sammy would come up from Carlisle just to do some training. Was that just a case of just learning more? Because I know that Lou did his online dojo of excellence. I don't know if you're a part of those.
I wasn't back then.
So what drew you to go down there? I know Lou does quite a few shows in Target over the course of the year. Was it just a case of going, well, I've got time, you've got time, all right, we'll go up to Glasgow and do some training?
That was kind of it. Like, I'll take any excuse to go to Glasgow. I'm in love with Glasgow. I can't wait to move back. But so we'd seen, obviously we know Lou King from like ICW and stuff like that, and then we'd seen him have some matches in Target, and they were just so entertaining. Like, Lou King sharp matches are like something you've never seen before. And then we find out he was doing the dojo. We're like, well, this is one of the best wrestlers in the UK. He's doing a dojo. It's in one of the best cities in the world. Let's go. We've got time. Let's absolutely go up there and do it. And it was, I think just from the first day we were there, I was like, yeah, this just feels right. Like, and we've went pretty much ever since. And it's so good. I can't stress enough, any trainee wrestlers who have the, you know, ability to get there, get to the Lou King Sharp Dojo of Excellence, you would never regret it.
I love Lou King Sharp. I think he's just excellent. I've said it on this podcast numerous times, said to him as well, that I think he just does everything right. Whereas either in the ring or in a business standpoint, a promotion standpoint, he's always well. He's good for giving you information, and he's just the guy. It's disgusting how young. And also the other hand of that is, it's disgusting how young he is, and yes, doing all this at the same time. It's just ridiculous. Because I remember seeing his first promo when he was the Fix Up Luke Sharp, and he had the hair greased over and that, and he was like 16. And I'm going, oh, this guy's very, very talented and loud already. And now was it, I don't know, 6-7 years, whatever, years later, and he's just
killing it.
Yeah, he's got. I mean, my only joke about it is, if he sat in his little black book, he'd be 6 foot tall, because he just knows everyone. He's got contacts everywhere.
The first time I actually met Lou King Sharp, this is pretty funny actually. It was after I initially tried wrestling, but like I couldn't afford it anymore. ICW did a burger eating contest at Lebowski's, like,
right,
years and years and years ago, and it's on their own streaming thing that they've got, and I was teamed up with Lou King Sharp in that burger eating contest like all those years ago. So if anyone can find it, you'll see a young non-wrestling Fulton King versus with Lou King Sharp trying to demolish a giant burger.
That is amazingly / weird claim to fame there. That's ace. Yeah. I love that. Yeah, we can go back and watch these things. Do you ever go back and watch it just to...
I have no idea. I've never been able to find it again. I think it's on the ICW streaming service, but it's not like obviously on the network or anything like that.
For someone to find it.
I've not actually seen it, but yeah, if they do, please tag me at it, because I'd love to see it again.
I think, judging by the questions that we've got, I think there'll be one guy that's definitely going to go have a wee search and use it for their own nefarious purposes. So before we get into the questions, because we have loads of questions, we'll kind of end the wrestling portion on Copenhagen Championship Wrestling. Speaking of Lou King Sharp, it was Glasgow Grindhouse. That's Lou King Sharp and Krieger against Legends Never Die, Sammy Sparks and Fulton King in a Choose Life match. Yeah. So this is a bit different. I mean, your style, as you've said throughout this is a fighting style. It's not the most technical, smooth, gifted, catch can, whatever kind of style. So this kind of works into your wheelhouse. What was it like? So choose life match. So akin to I Quit match, something new for you. What was that experience for you?
Purely being in the ring with, you know, Glasgow Grindhouse, Krieger and looking was unbelievable. Not that we spent a lot of time in the ring, most of it was getting battered. But it was a fantastic match. Again, another one I'm super proud of. Are the results out? Have you seen the results and stuff like that? Are they?
Yeah, they put the results up on their Facebook page. So I was like, oh, I'm taking them. even though they're going to be on TV.
Yeah. So we came out to it was an ICW tag team title shot. I kind of put them in the position to make that the case when I told them, look, what's the point in having these belts out with you if you're not going to defend them? And as soon as that happened, the boys decided, you know what, no more nice to TCR, and started laying into his. It was brutal. Kendo sticks, tables, bins to the head. I nearly went through the wall at the Lock Quantic Community Annex when Krieger launched me into it. But at the end up, the only way they could get the win on was by tying me to the ropes and just absolutely destroying Sammy. And I wasn't going to let my wee pal get hurt. So I chose life for Sammy, but I'm not satisfied with the ending of that. I think what Luke King and Krieger did was absolutely out of order. Glasgow Grindhouse have not seen the last of Legends Never Die. I'll put it that way.
This is going to be the feud to end all feuds for your next chapter in your wrestling career.
Yeah, man, those boys deserve everything that's coming to them after what they did. When you see the show, you'll understand. But yeah, they deserve it.
Looking forward to it. Right, so that's kind of we really kind of cliff noted your actual career itself by just like going spawn of target next. So if anyone wants to find out more, there's plenty of matches on YouTube that they can check out. Before we get into our fan questions, because you're the first time you've been on the show, that I get to ask the ridiculous questions that we get to ask again for this season. First up, I was going to retire them, but you know, if you're a first time guest, you have to be asked, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Oh. The one with the really big long neck. I forget the name of it.
Brachiosaurus or
Brachiosaurus?
Bronchosaurus or I don't know. You think I know names of dinosaurs at this point?
Either that one, or I think there's another dinosaur called a Diplodocusaurus, and I just think the name's hilarious.
Diplodocus, yeah, okay, cool. That's fine. And the other question we ask everyone, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Oh, one cow. I hate cows, I'm terrified of cows. One cow. One cow's destroying them. Easy.
Easy. Fair enough. So before we get into the big questions, I just want to thank you. If anyone hasn't already watched our Rise and Fall of ITV Celebrity Wrestling, you would have heard Fulton King providing the voice of Joey Legend. You were Joey Legend for that minute. Which I thank you very much, because I think it just made it that I got different people to do the voices, because you know, it was half an hour of me speaking, really. So
It was a good show, though. I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed the video, man. It was good.
Yeah, I don't know if I'll do any more. Like, I keep getting tempted by like Hulk Hogan Celebrity Championship Wrestling, but as I put on Twitter, it would just be me going Todd Bridges versus Robbed. So, you know, no. fuck you, Dez Rodman. That's going to be the end of it. So, did you watch it at the time, ITV Celebrity Wrestling? Was it? Do you remember it?
I remember it being on, like, and again, when you started putting the tweets out about it, I was like, I remember that. But it was so bizarre, because I remember D'Lo, from it, and obviously Roddy Piper. I didn't really know who Joey Legend was, but it just was so far removed from the professional wrestling that I'd watched, but it was unbelievable. It was just like, obviously just gladiators, but it was hilarious. I do remember it a bit.
Fascinating. I'm still hopeful that some of these contestants are going to get back to me. I had Scott Wright get back to me not long ago, who was Snake Eyes, but he kind of goes to me after I asked him if he wanted to speak to him, and Victoria Silverstead as well. She actually, we messaged back and forth, which was really weird, and she went, yeah, we could do that, and then that was it. Silence. So it's like everyone goes, oh yeah, we'll speak to you about it, and then they get flashbacks and memories of of celebrity, celebrity wrestling. They're like, no, we're not going to speak about it anymore. But no, it was very weird week. I was speaking to Lee Sharp because I was a Man U fan when I was younger, and it was like, this is very, very weird for me that I'm DMing Lee Sharp asking him about his broken ribs. Anyway, right, fan questions. So yeah, go check out everyone. It is an interesting half an hour. That's all I can really say about it. So we've got Ruby Roberts, of course, the basic bitch slayer. She asked, who's scarier in Fulton King's opinion, wrestling her or wrestling Jason from Friday the 13th for no particular reason?
Ruby Roberts, without a doubt, because I've never been hit harder than anyone than Ruby Roberts. She is the basic bitch slayer for a reason, and wow, she hits hard. Ruby Roberts, I'd be terrified to stand face to face in the ring with her on a show. Yeah, I really want her to come to Target Wrestling. She would just slap everyone silly, and that's not just the girls, she would battle the boys as well.
So I mean, the only way you can really get past her is just don't be a basic bitch about it, you know. That's so she can't slay you if you're a basic, if you're a basic bitch.
What makes someone a basic bitch, though? I feel like to her I might be a basic bitch. I don't think I am, but she still slapped me, let me tell you that.
So we've got Becca Little asked, how did you get into pro wrestling? I want to get into it, but I'm not sure where to start. So we've answered that first question, but for the second one, she wants to get into wrestling, not sure where to start. Any recommendations for her?
I think the most important thing is just take the dive and go for it. If you know there's a school nearby, so I don't know where Becca Little's based. If she's based, you know, Borders or Carlisle, Target Wrestling has a school. Glasgow, I can't recommend the, you know, Dojo of Excellence enough. And that's not just for guys that have been doing it forever, it's for absolutely anyone. So my biggest thing is find a school. You know, there's so many in Glasgow as well. There's so many about the place. The ones I can vouch for are going to be Target and Lou Kings. And yeah, if you can get to either of those, absolutely do it. Unbelievable stuff, and take the plunge.
And as someone who's outside the bubble as well, I would check who's training you. Just either, I mean, it may be a case of they might not be a mega star, but if they've been a focal point of a promotion for 10 years and they're drawing good crowds in a respectable promotion, then that's still important. So check. Don't pick the cheapest if it seems a bit sketchy. Again, outside the bubble, I've watched enough. It's about 10 years this year since I started watching Scottish wrestling, so I've seen some dodgy stuff go go my way, go like cross my eye line. So research is probably a good one as well.
Good piece of advice.
We've got Tanya and Alan Fulton, assume some relation. How did it feel having family at your match on Saturday?
It was amazing. It was the first time they'd ever seen me wrestle, and I felt a little bit bad about it because it was one of the most violent matches I've been in. But it was my mum, my dad, my sister, and then my two nieces, who are like both four. And at first I was like, I was more scared about my mum, to be fair. Like, because she's like, every time I've shown her a video, she's like, I couldn't be there. I'd jump in that ring and tell it, me stop hitting my boy. And I'm like, it's fine, like, it hurts, but I'm a big boy, mum, don't worry about it. It was bizarre because it was kind of like two worlds come together, because although they're my parents, they've never came to a wrestling show. And my sister and my nieces loved it. Let me tell you, like, I was with them the next day afterwards as well. And one of my nieces just kept going, Ruby sucks, you know, from Ruby Roberts. And the other one just kept putting her hands on her head, swiveling her hips and saying she was a big, strong man. So I think they had more of an impact on my nieces than I did. But no, it was really wholesome. It was really nice seeing them.
Excellent. So it's Stone Malone asking a favorite McFlurry.
This might be by Ruby Roberts. Absolutely slaps me because I like a plain McFlurry.
What's the point of a plain? Do who gets a plain McFlurry? The dogs. Because my dog gets a plain McFlurry. Very rarely.
I don't know why, man. I don't know, like, it's the texture thing, like, because I remember it was always Smarter McFlurries. I just didn't like the really hard crunch of the Smarties and with the McFlurries, so I just have to get him plain McFlurries. Don't get me wrong, though. If I go to, like, KFC, I'm getting an Oreo Crush'em a million times over.
Yeah. I'm not a fan of Oreos, but you know, that's just me. I just find that they just taste like stale biscuits. We've got Michael Brian Frank, the Wanderer, asking, what do legends do?
Legends never die, my man. Legends never die.
There we go. There's the t-shirt. We'll get into Judas Gray.
Yeah.
Because he's asked so many questions. Oh God, there's a third. Oh, Jesus,
there's so many.
Yeah, okay, right. We may need to just rattle these. So, okay, Judas Gray, why are you so English?
I'm not English. I just live in England. He's from Edinburgh. Barely counts. The answer to that, Judas Gray, is I'm going to slap you silly next time I see you.
I'm just actually reading through the questions. Some may come back to, some may be familiar. Okay, so when will we have a Spotfest triple threat?
If Spotfest, it means I'm just going to pick him up and throw him off as many things as possible, hopefully sooner rather than later.
Are you still scared of me?
Never have been, absolutely never will be.
Why are you so English?
I'm going to slap you silly, Judas Gray.
Why did you team with Sammy Sparks?
It's
actually a nice question. In this.
That is a nice question.
He did put the sick emoji. He did do the vomiting emoji afterwards, though.
It's a backhanded compliment. I said before, I absolutely love Sammy Sparks. We know each other so well. And there's just a chemistry there that I think we couldn't let go, and we just had to see what we could do with it.
Why are you so English?
I'm going to slap him silly.
Would you...
Oh no, what's he done?
Stop asking this question. Would you like to join DMG? Do you know
is
what
that DMG? To do with Judas Gray?
Do you know what DMG is?
I don't know. No.
Right, okay. So this is season 4.5, I'll tell you. DMG, everyone go back into the Judas Gray's episode and he'll reveal all. Is the dead mum gang.
Oh my god. I'd rather not. My mum should see me wrestle once. I'd like her to come here a few more shows.
Speaking of that, I was like, it felt really bad at the time, but you know how the Queen died recently, and I did tweet asking if King Charles was now a member of TMG.
I think he is. Like,
I mean, technically he is, but I don't know if he's got a card to say so. But oh, he's. That question is gonna haunt me, and he's gonna ask it for every single episode now, and I'm gonna have to explain what DMG is to people. Okay, how do we move from there? So he did ask, was it Sammy or Fulton King that chose life? We know the answer, so that's fine. Then there's a back and forth between him and Sammy, so we'll just kind of skip that. And finally, we've got, why weren't you at Catty?
So this is from a few weeks ago. Sammy went to Cat House with a bunch of other people, ended up bumping into Stone Malone, ended up bumping into Judas Gray. I was supposed to be there, but I tested positive for COVID the day of, so I couldn't go. I really appreciate that he missed me, though. But no, I couldn't. Didn't want to be that guy, you know?
I just got a feeling if you meet Judas, he's got, like, you know how you see... Jehovah's Witnesses with the Watchtower, that he's got like a little leaflet about DMG.
And he's just... Would you like to be a card-carrying member of DMG?
Would you like to learn more? we can arrange it. Anyway, so we've got Case and Riley asking, this is the last question I've got through Twitter. I've got one on Instagram, which I think is going to be the nice closer. Sure. Case and Riley asking, 8 matches, make a dream card.
Right, so I love Casey. He's a really, really good guy. If anyone hasn't seen his work, they should definitely book him. And for this dream card, me and Casey and Riley one-on-one, I want that match to happen. I've been dying for that match to happen for a long time. So that's one. We've also got, I'd want, give me Sammy Sparks, Judas Gray, and Robbie Cardwell in a triple threat. That would be absolutely chaos. Owen Aussie Michaels versus Gaia Hawks. That would be some match. There's we got Chris Kendall versus Raw. Yeah, Chris Kendall versus Raw would be a good one. Medallion versus Stone Malone. I just want to see them battle alongside each other. I'd love absolutely every bit of that. Who else we got? I'm trying to mix my target worlds with all the other ones as well.
It sounds like quite a target slash Copenhagen Championship Wrestling invasion kind of
show
we've got going on here. Show.
Let's see, who else we got? Dylan Thorne. Let's put him against Chris Kendall. That'll be a good match. That'll be a good one. And then I'll work double duty. Death Row versus Legends Never Die. Death Row, the PCW Tag Team Champions. But only if they're putting those belts in the line. I want Priscilla in a match here because Priscilla, Queen of the Ring, is unbelievable. Do you know what? I've already seen this match, but I want to see it again. Give me Priscilla versus Kid Bandit. That match was fantastic. I'll forget every one of them, but that would be an amazing card.
That's fine. I thought I can't remember if I thought Chris Kendall maybe on double G as well, but I've kind of forgotten. I don't have a good memory for these things. So it's a like nice little mix of matches. It's I like that you made a card that is like possible as well. That you just went right. Me versus Kevin Owens, and then second match is. It's a gauntlet. It's me versus Seth Rollins. I'm just doing that. Right.
See, me say beforehand.
So I'm going to get into Instagram and find the last question as my internet starts to crap out, which, you know, good timing because we're near the end. We've got him with the face on Instagram asking, why so handsome?
I don't know. Yeah, him with the face is one of my oldest friends, so thank you very much, Callum. I appreciate that. I'm just going to ask, why is he so handsome? Because him with the face is an absolute babe. Also, him with the face is like 6'4", and I'm dying for him to get in the ring. It's one of these ones where it took me a while to figure this out, but apparently I'm quite a big guy. But because I grew up around people who were taller than me, I never noticed it. So like John from Target was like, you're a big guy, do more big guy stuff. And I'm like, all right. Okay. And it took ages to draw that in. But thank you, him with the face. I appreciate it very much.
Put those moonsaults away. You're doing big slams instead. You're doing uranagis. That's your role.
Big uranagis, yeah.
That's kind of where we're up to. So this episode's going to go in as of recording in about a week's time. So what have you got to look forward to? What's your kind of next goals in terms of wrestling? What you want to do? What you want to accomplish? Tell me everything.
Well, me and Sammy had an ICW tag team title shot at a Copenhagen Championship Wrestling show. I would love to have that match on an ICW show in Glasgow, anywhere. I also have a bone to pick with Chris Kendall, and coming up, that boy's going to get the beating of his life for what he did. I think I'm going to get about as much as possible. I'm moving back up to Glasgow come December, so hopefully I'll get in a few more shows up there as well. That'd be really nice, get more into the Scottish scene. That's what's coming up so far. That's what I've got planned.
What's your dream then? So of course you mentioned ICW Glasgow again about that, but is there an end game? If you got signed by NXT Europe, if you got a chance to work at, I know, AEW or Japan, what would be your moment that you'd sit back and go, yeah, I could probably retire at this point now?
Honestly, I don't know. Being offered an opportunity with AEW or NXT or New Japan would all be absolutely incredible. But I've always thought I came into wrestling when I was like 27 years old. My wrestling goal is just to be as good as I possibly can be and put on as good a show as I possibly can. As long as I'm achieving that, I'm absolutely happy and I'll keep on doing it. And anything else would just be an absolute bonus.
Wonderful. Well, thank you very much for joining me today. And for anyone who wants to find out more about Fulton King, where can people find out more about you on social media? Or I don't know if you want to give out your address, but you know, how can people find out more about Fulton King?
You can get me on Twitter at the Fulton King. I regularly have back and forth with some people, Lucha DS being one of them. He hates me for some reason. I'm on Instagram. I'm on Instagram. It's just a normal one, Adam FULTN. And you can catch me on Copenhagen Championship Wrestling wherever possible. Dean Spotton shall be coming out soon, so you'll see a hell of a match on that. Target Wrestling. You see me on pretty much all of their shows. I'm lucky enough to get on them. And you'll see me having a great time and battering some dafties.
Excellent. You and masked folk, eh? That's just conspiracy. Excellent. But no, thank you very much for speaking to me today.
Thank you, mate. I really appreciate it. Thanks for having me.